Thank you. Thank you. I'm very, very happy to be here in Mampad, and I'm very happy to see so many young faces. It feels like I always feel at home in a room with young faces. I've been teaching for a very long time. It's a great honor and privilege for me that you have invited me here. What I'm going to talk about today is, three voices from early 20th century India. I'm going to look at three texts, Gandhi's Hind Swaraj, Ambedkar's essay called Gandhism, and a very interesting short story written by a woman called Rukhaya Sakhawat Hussain. All these three, and that story is called Sultana's Dream. It's a short story. So I'll talk about these three texts and what they say about self, labor, and technology, which is the theme of your conference. And what is interesting for us is to think about why these three voices are different. In what ways are they different? And what is the reason they are different? And what can we learn from all three through a critical analysis? So I begin with the understanding that when we speak from somewhere. And by speech, I mean whether we write or whether we think, we are located somewhere. We are not unlocated. We are rooted in some place. We are rooted in some identity. Our speech emerges from that place. So there's a very interesting Caribbean thinker called, Argentinian thinker, sorry, called Walter Mignolo. And he put it this way. He said we should think of it like this, that I am where I think. You know, he's obviously playing with I think, therefore I am. And he says, I am where I think. And what he means by that is that where you're located, the place where you're located, will inflect and shape how you think, how you speak, and in a sense who you are. And that place is obviously not an office or a library or a home, but the place is a particular matrix of power. And he calls it a colonial matrix of power. Of course, I think we would have to say that that space where we are all located is shaped by many kinds of power relations and conflicts. So it's shaped by caste, gender, class, community identity, and many other kinds of identities. And so you are kind of, you grow in a particular location. So if we take this idea seriously, so I want to place two ideas before I go into those texts. One is this, I am where I think, which is Walter Mignolo's idea. The other idea I want to place before you is the question of who is it who thinks? So the idea of the self, right? Who is the self? Who is it who thinks? And here I'm going to use the argument made by a Sri Lankan anthropologist and philosopher called Gananath Obasekere, who says that we have to recognize that while human beings have always had a notion of personhood, that is, we have, all cultures have thought about human beings as people with certain roles, certain responsibilities, certain identities. Now, this idea of the person, I think this is too close. Isn't it too close? That the idea of a human actor as a carrier of roles, rights, and responsibilities is something that has existed in many cultures, and it has taken different shapes and forms through time. But the idea of self in the European tradition, which has become universalized, so the idea of the self it implies there is an implication, and this is an idea that emerges from the European Enlightenment. There is an implication that when you grow up, when the self grows up, it becomes a proper individual. A proper autonomous individual with no community identity, no other identities, just one autonomous monadic individual. So there's a kind of, it's implied that Europe has achieved this status and the rest of the world will gradually also grow up and all become individuals. So this idea of the self is something that many philosophers and thinkers of our parts of the world have contested, that the idea that individuation is natural, it's inevitable, it's desirable, this idea has been challenged by many, many thinkers from the global south. And in fact, if you look at this idea that something, that when you say I, the self, that I stops at the borders of my skin. This is me. This idea is not the way in which, for example, most of you would identify, right? Most of us don't identify like that. This idea is only 500 years old. It's come from Europe. And it's not something that you find in many parts of the world. So if you look at non-Western societies, this idea that there's an individual which is separate from all other individuals, that you're born as an individual, when you study sociology, those of you who are sociology students, we are taught, because we are taught the same thing that emerges from the West, the basic unit of society is the individual, right? Then the individual is part of a family, the family is part of community. That is not actually the way we are in our parts of the world. So what we find is that in our parts of the world, and if you look at, for example, if you look at even our anti-imperialist struggles, you look at Gandhi or Ambedkar over here, or you look at African anti-imperialists such as in Nyerere or in Nkrumah, most nationalist leaders didn't address the people of that anti-imperialist struggle as individuals. They were addressed as members of national communities. So the language of politics in our parts of the world has remained non-individualistic. And so it's always, we always think of ourselves in connection to other selves. When you say I, you don't think just me, you think in terms of a community, a class, a caste, and so on. And the third point I want to make about the self, so one is I am where I think. The other is that we are not born individuals. Individuation is a process that has to be learned, and we actually don't ever learn it. We never think of ourselves as individuals in our parts of the world. This is not necessarily good or bad. It has good aspects and bad aspects, not to think of yourself as an individual. But it's just a situation. And the third recognition we must recognize, we must take on board, is that when you think of the self is very much constituted through the social division of labor. So when you think of yourself as who am I, that includes the labor that your body does. And this labor is decided by social division of labor through caste, primarily in this society in India, through caste, and all over the world through gender. There's a patriarchal division of labor and there's a Brahminical division of labor. And these two different, so that women do certain kinds of work and they're supposed to do certain kinds of work regardless of class or any other thing. There is a division of labor, right? There's a sexual division of labor. And there's a caste-based, so Brahminical and patriarchal divisions of labor. And so from the moment of one's birth, and in the case of caste and community identity, from the moment you're conceived, you're already inside frameworks of gender, caste, community, identity, and class, which will tell you what labor our bodies have to perform, right? That is determined for some of us before birth, and often, and for others after birth. That is, if you're born a woman, then there's a certain kind of labor you have to perform. And if you're born into a particular caste, that you know from your mother's womb, that this is the labor you will have to perform. Now, with these three points in mind, let me take you through these texts that the paper engages with on the question of self, labor, and technology. Now, Hind Swaraj was published in English in 1909. It was first written in Gujarati, and then Gandhi rewrote it in English. Ambedkar's essay, Gandhism, was published in 1945, but it actually engages with all of Gandhi's work up to that point. It's a very sharp, critical essay about Gandhi. And Rokeya Sakhawat Hussain's short story, Sultana's Dream, was written in English in 1905, and it was published in 1908. So these are three contemporary voices. And we need to remind ourselves, when you say, I am where I think, Gandhi is a Savarna Hindu male, Ambedkar is a Dalit male, and Hussein is a Muslim woman. And so how do these specific subject positions inflect what they're saying? So we will take up two themes in these three very complex texts, modernity and ecological awareness. And we look at how these texts engage with modernity and ecological awareness. So Hind Swaraj is an outright rejection of modernity and a celebration of tradition. Modernity is seen as producing social disorder. Gandhi is very, very critical of modernity for this reason, especially, and social disorder is produced through technology and machinery that produces desolation and takes human beings away from nature. Gandhism and Sultana's dream, on the other hand, celebrate modernity. So Hind Swaraj is absolutely critical of modernity and civilization. It doesn't have one good thing to say for it. But Gandhism and Sultana's dream celebrate modernity as freedom from oppressive tradition and technology as liberation from menial labor that destroys human capacity for creativity. And the second theme I'll come to would be with reference to ecology and how these three texts can be read with regard to their response to technological developments and what that means for nature. I'm going to read the rest of the paper and we can take up questions later. In Hind Swaraj, Gandhi attacked civilization, which he sees as identical to modernity, as a state of things in which bodily comfort is made the object of life. His criticism of civilization has two aspects. One is a critique of a sort of capitalist consumerism. He doesn't use the words capitalist consumerism, but he's talking about adopting European clothing, learning to want things one doesn't need. He says this is what civilization does to you. You just want to imitate the West and you want everything that they have. So he criticizes civilization for that reason. He also, and the other aspect, so one is a critique of consumerism and imitation of the West, and the other is a celebration of manual labor. Because according to him, manual labor provides work for everybody. It keeps human beings close to nature, while mechanization and industrialization lead to large-scale devastation. So Gandhi was influenced in this, as we know, by Western romantic critiques of modernity and industrialization, thinkers like Thoreau, Tolstoy, and Ruskin. And his own critique of exploitative conditions in factories and mines for men and women is based on a celebration of the previous era when men worked in the open air only as much as they liked, and women were queens of households. So this was the ideal. Women were, so there was a, so he's fully naturalizing the domestic division of labor, where women will be in the household, men were working in the fields. This is actually not true of agrarian societies. Women work a lot outside the home. Otherwise, agrarian societies wouldn't survive. But this is the way he's romanticizing it. Machinery has impoverished India, he says, referring to the way in which the mills of Manchester have destroyed Indian handicraft. And he actually says it's better to send money to Manchester and use that terrible flimsy Manchester cloth than to multiply mills in India, because the horrors of reproducing Manchester in India are far greater. So he says, what is the alternative? Live simply, have few needs, reject, for example, electric bulbs, live with earthen lamps, do without all the necessary or unnecessary objects that civilization teaches us to want, but what we don't really need. So this is the perspective from which Gandhi urges us to return to the village republic, local small communities that are self-sufficient. Now, Ambedkar, in his essay Gandhism, offers a devastating critique of the social and economic program that is revealed by Gandhi's call to return to the village. It becomes clear, because Ambedkar cites Gandhi himself a lot in this essay, and it becomes clear that Gandhi's rejection of machinery has to be understood in the context of his open propagation of Varnashram Dharma, which is a certain kind of reworked caste system that he offers, Gandhi offers. So essentially, Ambedkar argues, Gandhi is simply reworking the traditional caste system in his own terms while retaining its horrific hierarchies. In fact, Ambedkar says that the Bhagavad Gita is better than Gandhi. Even the Bhagavad Gita is more progressive than Gandhi because the Bhagavad Gita has two merits in comparison to Gandhi's views. It does not base Varna on birth. The Bhagavad Gita does not base Varna on birth and argues that Varna is based on the qualities of the human being. And also the Bhagavad Gita does not say the occupation of the son should be the occupation of the father. But for Gandhi, Varna is determined by birth and to be continued by heredity. So Ambedkar is so critical of Gandhi that he says even the Bhagavad Gita has a more progressive view of caste than Gandhi does. So Ambedkar reads Gandhi's hostility to machinery in this context. In his understanding, the evils of modern society are not due to machinery, but to wrong social organization, which has made private property and pursuit of personal gain matters of absolute sanctity. So he's, as we know, Ambedkar was very much influenced by Marxism and socialism. So from a Marxist-socialist perspective, Ambedkar is arguing for the reorganization of society so that benefits will not be taken by a few. Now, so he says human beings must be freed from manual labor. Why? Because he says, and I'm quoting Ambedkar, the distinctively human function is reason. Man thus occupies the highest place in the scheme of animate existence. What divides brute from man, animal from man, is culture. So the aim of human society should be to enable every person to cultivate the mind and lead a life of culture. So Ambedkar says there's a difference between merely living and living worthily. And how to live worthily? You need leisure. And how do you get leisure? Through freedom from manual labor. So Ambedkar is saying that Gandhi's hatred of machinery is actually based on a distrust of democracy. And Ambedkar says that a truly democratic society must ensure a life of leisure and culture to all its citizens. And then he says this, the slogan of a democratic society must be machinery and more machinery, civilization and more civilization. Right? So you can see now, so this is where Ambedkar is coming from. Absolutely yes to machinery and an end to manual labor. Now we come to Rokeya Sakhawat Hussain, about whom I'll give a very brief introduction because unlike Gandhi and Ambedkar, she's not so well known. She was from a wealthy Zamindari family in what is now Bangladesh. She was born in Bengal. She was born in the late 19th century. She died in 1932. She was married to a widower much older than her who encouraged her to study and go out in society. And he died after 13 years of marriage, leaving Rokeya with a fortune that she used to start a girls' school, Sakhawat Memorial Girls' School, which still survives. In 1916, she founded Muslim Women's Association, offering poor Muslim women financial assistance, literacy classes, and shelter. And she wrote extensively in Bangla and in English, addressing women readers directly, especially Muslim women, encouraging them to lead public lives and to give up domestic seclusion. So this story that we're going to discuss was written originally in English, Sultana's Dream. And now, what is the story? It's a kind of fantasy. It's a futuristic, utopian fantasy. It's a fantasy of a better world, right? It's like science fiction in a sense. But the story is, it's said in like a dream. So it's about this woman, Sultana. She falls asleep and she dreams of a place called Ladyland. That's the name of, she wakes up and she thinks she's woken up, and in her dream, she's in a place called Ladyland. And Ladyland is run entirely by women, and it has a female ruler, a queen. Women walk freely and without covering their faces, and men are shut up indoors. And it's called the Zanana. The men are shut up indoors, but it's still called the Zanana. Now, Sultana is shown around by a native of Ladyland, a woman called Sara. And Sara explains to her that we should lock up those who are dangerous. So it's the men who are dangerous and who pose a danger. That's why we've locked them up. Then there is compulsory education for all women and marriage is banned before the age of 21. As a result, women are highly educated and learned, and women scientists have invented marvelous machines that have created a world in which you have to only work if you enjoy it, and there is plenty of leisure, no crime. So then Sultana walks around Ladyland, she looks at the universities, the laboratories, and so on, and then she wakes up from her dream. Now, this is the brief account of Sultana's dream. I'm going to come back to this. But let's think about what I began with, that I am where I think. So if you think about that, the relationship to an understanding of the body and labor in these three texts is obviously very different. Ambedkar and Hussain, located as they are in communities that are relegated compulsorily to manual work by a casteist and patriarchal division of labor, celebrate modernity and machinery that bring with them the possibility of liberation from menial work, right? So Ambedkar as a Dalit facing a Brahminical division of labor which makes Dalits perform the most menial and degrading manual labor. Rokeya Sakhawat Hussain as a woman who knows that her fate and the fate of all women is to only perform household work and be solely responsible for household work even if they work outside the house. So these two people are obviously not going to celebrate manual labor because for them manual labor is compulsory. As a Dalit and as a woman, for them manual labor is compulsory. Whereas Gandhi, located as he is by gender and caste in a position that makes manual labor purely voluntary, you can do it if you want. Gandhi can clean toilets if he wants. But a Dalit from a particular community has to lift night soil. As you know, even today we have dry latrines in India, which is a blot upon our democracy. So Gandhi makes is able to glorify and romanticize manual labor because it's a purely voluntary task for him because he's from a caste and a gender where he doesn't have to do it. Now, I'm going to move to ecology. We'll come back to all three texts again and especially to Sultana's dream again because I've only given you a very brief idea about it so far. Now, none of these texts refer specifically to technology or technological developments. But all of them take machinery seriously. And all of them share the perception that machinery reduces human toil. But Gandhi thinks it's bad to reduce human toil, and Hussain and Ambedkar believe it's a good thing. So the early 20th century in India is actually marked by conflicting responses to technological development. So we've had writers such as Ambedkar, we just talked about, M. N. Roy, Nehru, who participated in the modernist triumphant kind of a triumphalism coming from the European Enlightenment regarding technology. But others, there were like Gandhi and Tagore, who were suspicious of technology and the manner in which it alienated humans from nature. Tagore was, of course, not quite Gandhi's position. He was equally suspicious of Gandhi's call to turn to the charkha. But I won't go into Tagore unless you're interested in the discussion. Now, of the three thinkers that we've discussed here, Ambedkar's text, Gandhism, reflects most closely the understanding of the European Enlightenment that the distinctively human function is reason. And Ambedkar goes on to add that man occupies the highest place in the scheme of animate existence. So his critique of Gandhi includes a dismissal of European romantics such as Thoreau, Ruskin and Tolstoy as primitive. So today if you look at the field of Dalit intellectuals, in a sense, the inheritors of this moment of Ambedkar's thought, because as we will see in a minute, Ambedkar's views changed later. But this moment of Ambedkar's thought, where he celebrates machinery, celebrates industrialization, and thinks that human beings are the masters of nature, that's a very typical European Enlightenment position. That idea changes later, but the inheritors of this moment of Ambedkar's thought you will find today in Dalit intellectuals like Chandrabhan Prasad, who celebrate Dalit capitalism. They say there should be Dalits who are capitalists. So he's not anti-capitalist, he celebrates capitalism. For example, Chandrabhan Prasad is very critical of the Narmada Bachao Andolan and all ecological movements because he says that these ecological movements want to restore traditional ways of living, and traditional ways of living are anti-Dalit. What is interesting though when you look at Ambedkar is that there appears to be a radical shift in his thought from this modernist, very human-centric, instrumentalizing relationship to nature, especially after his conversion to Buddhism. And V.M. Ravi Kumar has argued that Ambedkar offers us in his last text, Buddha and his Dhamma, something that Ravi Kumar calls egalitarian environmentalism. So Ambedkar's views on nature shifted when he converted to Buddhism. And what Ravi Kumar tells us is that Ambedkar starts thinking in a very different way about the relationship between human beings and nature. And Ambedkar proposes this Buddhist idea of Maitri, which is fellowship not just among human beings, but between human beings and non-human nature. So after his conversion to Buddhism towards the end of his life, Ambedkar is no longer this great celebrator of industrialization and machinery which is going to devastate nature. So there's a very interesting ecological argument that Ambedkar starts to make in the latter part of his life. And Ravi Kumar tells us that Ambedkar proposes a self-emphatic and reflexive ethical code for human beings while engaging with other species. So this later development in Ambedkar's thought suggests that his views on technology and its relationship to nature were reshaped by a Buddhist perception of the interrelatedness of all things while retaining a socialist Marxist critique of the deeply unjust Brahminical caste order. Now, when you turn to Gandhi, the critique of his social program in endorsing Varnashrama Dharma is obviously, we continue to hold, stand by it. But we do need to recognize that there was an ecological awareness in Gandhi in his critique of machinery as alienating. Today, what Gandhi says in 1939, reflecting on Hind Swaraj, is he says it was not an attempt to go back to the so-called ignorant dark ages, but it's an attempt to see beauty in voluntary simplicity, voluntary poverty, and interestingly, he says, and slowness. Isn't that interesting? In modern society, when speed is what is celebrated, everything has to be fast. If you look at this advertisements for mobile networks, this is the fastest network. Everything has to happen instantly. Fast food, right? Everything has to be fast. And he celebrated slowness. And today in the 21st century, when we have gone through one century of devastation, ecological devastation, when nature no longer is under our control, we can see the cyclones, we can see the tsunamis, we can see all the different ways in which we have, in a sense, angered nature, right? And in which nature's taking revenge. In this context, the ecological awareness that Gandhi shows is perhaps something we can take seriously while being critical of its anti-democratic character. So the idea that slowness is something that we should value is worth thinking about. And in the 21st century today, it's no longer possible to ignore the voices of critique that have emerged even from within the West of the European Enlightenment and its very instrumentalizing use of reason and nature. So from this perspective, we may see Gandhi as one of the earliest voices to sound a warning to the triumphalism of the European Enlightenment and as an inspiration for 21st century attempts to reevaluate slowness in the face of speed and embrace voluntary rejection of consumerist acquisitiveness. What mars Gandhi's perspective on technology and its destructive relationship to nature is, of course, his deep distrust of uncontrolled democracy. And that is evident in Hind Swaraj. He's very critical of the fact that, oh, now the printing press allows anybody to write and express his views. Earlier, only wise men could express their views. He thinks it's a good thing that earlier only a few wise men could express their views, and now through the printing press, everybody can express their views. I wonder what he would think of the social media, right? Where anyone with access to anything can express their views, and it's equally on par with whether you're the greatest intellectual or a 12-year-old. All the views are the same. I wonder what he would think about it, and we can think about that. So we need to recover Gandhi's ecological awareness from this lack of democracy that we find. You find it in his politics also, right? He withdrew the non-cooperation movement when Chauri Chaura happened, despite the fact that there was a huge mass mobilization. He never supported the Royal Indian Navy mutiny. He was very, very uncomfortable with Bhagat Singh. He was very critical of peasants and workers, when they went on strike against mill owners, when they fought, when they had struggles against zamindars. So his environmentalism does not base itself on democracy, but so we need to recover it and put it in a democratic perspective. Now we come to Hussein's story. And here we find an awareness of patriarchal gender relations, which is completely missing in the other two texts, as well as, in my opinion, a much more evolved environmentalism than both Gandhi's and that of Ambedkar in that text called Gandhism, although, as we saw later, Ambedkar later developed a more complex perspective. Now, Hussein is astonishingly prescient. She's like a visionary. In the early 20th century, she is imagining in Ladyland renewable sources of energy. So in Ladyland, the energy is coming from the sun and the wind. This is early 20th century. Even in the 21st century, people haven't seriously, and states and governments haven't seriously taken into account renewable sources of energy. Rokeya Sakhawat Hussein in the early 20th century is imagining a world which is run by solar power, which is run by wind power. There are air cars that work on hydrogen and electricity. We're talking about electric cars now. She's talking about a balloon that draws water from the atmosphere and produces rain when you need it. She's in Ladyland is also, she also thinks about it in very democratic terms. She, Ladyland is anti-war. So how does Ladyland deal with invading armies? They direct the power of the sun onto that army and all the weapons get burnt up. And the men in the army, because they are men, run away from fear, right? And because they're burning under the sun. So then they never come to war with Ladyland again. Why do they have a war? Because the queen refuses to turn away refugees. What sort of a text is this? Who is this woman, right? Why haven't we heard more about her? This young woman in 1908 writing a story about how a country refuses to turn away refugees, and so the other country from where the refugees have come try to wage war. So there is that. There is no religion in Ladyland except that of love and truth. And the state does not take life. So the only punishment is exile from Ladyland. So Hussein, you can see, locates her celebration of technology within a harmonious relationship with nature, as well as within a larger democratic and ethical horizon. But there's one category of humans who fares very badly in Ladyland, right? Who don't do well at all, and that is men. And because men are locked up in the zanana. And what is interesting is, now I'll tell you, I don't think we should take this as a literal account. What she's doing here is very interesting. So she tells us that as she's walking with Sara on the road, some other women, there are no men on the road, some other women start laughing at her. So she asks Sara, why are they laughing at me? And Sara says, because you look so mannish. She says, I look mannish. And she says, yes, you're looking so timid and so shy. You're looking so mannish. So what is Rokeya Sakhawat Hussein telling us? That if you lock one category of people up and teach them to be shy, they will become shy. So by saying this, they've become shy and timid because they live in Parda, and Sultana is called Manish. Now, and this Sultana's guide is very cruel. She says, men are fit for nothing. Catch them and put them into the zanana. Now, Hussein read out this story to her husband, and he said, a terrible revenge. He was really shocked by the story. What a revenge that women have taken on men. But it would be a mistake, I think, to read Sultana's Dream as an anti-male text. That is not her point. The point of the story is not to be anti-men or to say that men should be locked up. What she's doing is she's showing us a mirror image of gender domination, right? So when you invert gender domination and show you, then you're suddenly very shocked. Oh, the men are locked up. Oh, the men have become shy because they're taught to be shy. Oh, men can only do housework. So by shocking you through that inversion, she's reminding you that the exact opposite of that is happening in the real world. An entire category of people have been locked up. And this is not just Muslim women, but there's a sexual division of labor by which all women have to put aside all their ambitions and hopes and dreams in order to do only housework, right? So It seems to me that it's showing us a mirror image of gender domination to shock the reader into an awareness of the terrible injustice faced by women in the real world. The direct inversion of sexist ideology shows us how irrational this ideology is when directed against women, and how the functioning of a world based on this ideology stunts the development of human capacities. So all three see the self as constituted by labor, but while Ambedkar and Hussein have a notion of work that can be pleasurable, Hussein and Ambedkar both believe that we should be able to do the work that makes us happy. So in Ladyland, there are women who are doing embroidery and all of that. They enjoy that. And Ambedkar also says leisure, life of culture, we should be able to do work that we enjoy doing, only work that we enjoy doing. Interestingly, Gandhi is so ascetic, he has no conception of pleasure. Those of us who have even read his autobiography, we know that. He's very suspicious of pleasure, Gandhi. So Gandhi has no conception of pleasure. He completely disavows pleasure. Ambedkar and Hussein want a world in which enforced, demeaning division of labor between castes and genders has ceased and ended within a radically democratized order. Gandhi's vision is of a world in which voluntary physical labor by all transforms the self, but he does not suggest how this is to be achieved except through voluntary renunciation of power by the powerful. So through these three texts, what I would suggest in conclusion is that one is that we come to take seriously the three points that I began with, that we don't think and we are not human beings in a vacuum. If you just say human beings, it means nothing. Because all of us are located in some way, in some structural way. It's not just something in our heads, right? There are structural ways in which we are produced as women or Hindu or Muslim or Dalit or Savarna and so on, or white or black in the Western context. So we are located in these different ways and our thought emerges from those spaces. So by looking at these three texts and the ways in which these three very differently located people think about self, labor, and technology, it seems to me that we can think of a new world for the 21st century. And for me, the way is led by this young Muslim woman who in the early 20th century dreamed of a world in which all human beings are equal and there is democracy and we are at and that we exist with nature in such a way that we don't destroy the planet but live in harmony with nature. So for me, if you look at these three texts, I learned most from Rukaya Sakhawat Hussain's text. But if you put all three of them together, we get, I think, very interesting ways in which we can think of how to live in the 21st century. Thank you.